everybody. I have Jordan with me today, and we're going to be talking about kind of the change of discussion and landscape surrounding automation over the last couple of years. And Jordan's introduction will help you understand why she's really well suited to answer these questions. So before we dive in, Jordan, can you give everybody a quick introduction?
Of course. Hi, my name is Jordan Mullins. I'm the Deputy Divisional Director for the Intelligent Automation Network. We are a community, a production company. We put together events. Well, originally we were putting together live events. Now we put together digital events. We also put together reports. We put together anything and everything to do within the intelligent automation space. Just recently, we also launched a podcast called Intelligent Automation Talk.
And that podcast is part of the reason that I reached out to Jordan, because I started hearing the interviews that she was doing and was super interested in having a conversation of our own. So with that experience, especially these events, unfortunately not in person anymore, but you're having conversations about the automation landscape and digital transformation all over the place. So can you share some of the, you know, shifts or kind of things that you've seen changing over the last couple of years within the automation landscape?
Absolutely. So the Intelligent Automation Network has been running events, both digital and in person, for about 5 years now. And I would say that RPA really used to be our bread and butter. It was the area where people felt the most comfortable talking about. It was the area with the most use cases. It was the technology that, it was basically the gateway technology to broader intelligent automation tools. Now though, what I'm seeing, and it's definitely been the case for at least the past 18 months, and you know, 2020 and the pivot to working from home has definitely accelerated this interest and engagement, has really been more towards combining RPA with intelligent automation tools like artificial intelligence and machine learning. Other areas of interest are process discovery and process mining, task mining, areas where, you know, it's less robotic process automation, which is really, like, I have heard quite a few times being called the muscle of automation. And really there's been a shift more towards the brain of automation and looking at real applying these heavy lift tools with a bit more intelligence.
I like that, the muscle versus the brain. I've heard other people talk about, my co-host for the other show that I do, Kieran, talks about the clickety-click versus the thinkity-think. But I haven't heard anybody call RPA the gateway automation tool. And it makes me chuckle a little, but it's very true. It's often the starting point of the conversations with intelligent automation. So as we take a look at, you know, RPA and intelligent automation as a whole maturing as an industry, where do you see the strongest use cases coming from these conversations that you're having?
So I feel like you and I say this a lot. I know that I've seen you comment on it, and I know I say this a lot in my calls, but the most common saying is you go for the low-hanging fruit. You tackle the use cases that provide the quick, that really tackle the quick, repeatable tasks. They're usually the tasks that are low-skilled and can be scaled because there is just so much of them repeated throughout the company. But what does that actually even mean? What it means to me is that areas like accounts payable are really, really taking to automation because of the influx of invoices and payments and vendors that have to be managed. And what that means is that there's so much repeatable tasks on a day-to-day basis that can really be automated that make it the most, I guess, prone to automation, to an automation like RPA as well, specifically. The industries that have really, really taken to automation, I would say, have been finance and insurance, as well as third-party logistics. And I really do think that that is because you see this scale of invoices coming through that makes automation invoices a prime target for automation.
That's exactly what you said, that idea of starting with those easily repeatable processes and moving your way to complex as your own initiatives continue to scale is certainly right in line with what I talk about. And it's interesting to hear from your perspective, you know, insurance, financial, those are two areas that we hear a lot about. But the logistics one is not necessarily one that gets the primetime light quite as much. So that's an interesting thought from you and kind of what you're seeing with the events that you guys are putting on and the conversations you're having. So my next question is, you know, what does that mean from your perspective about the future of automation and where there continues to be opportunity?
So I definitely see this in the maturity curve of our attendees, as well as the conversations I'm having on a day-to-day basis. I definitely see the future of automation really being influenced by the cloud. I see that process mining and discovery are two areas that are absolutely on fire at the moment. But when it comes to the actual conversation around, I guess, automation, I'm seeing customer experience actually take a really interesting shift in perspective. People that are, you know, for at least the Intelligent Automation Network events, we've historically had a lot of people from the back office. They are people that are usually not really customer facing. However, as organizations de-silo, as they start to become a little bit more straight through in the way that they process payments, as well as how they process new customers, what it means is that they're starting to treat that philosophy of making things easier for the customer, but then also taking that idea of customer centricity to the employee and asking what is easier for the employee. As that philosophy takes over, I think we're going to see a renaissance in the way automation is used. You know, I think after doing this event for, you know, over 2 years now, I think personally what I'm seeing is people have, you know, tried to do their first automation initiative. They might have failed. They're on their second or even third. And so they're looking for new ways to ensure that some of the biggest hurdles to automation, such as the change management piece, are really being tackled with a people-first perspective.
It's interesting that you mentioned kind of the convergence of your employee experience or back office type processes with the customer experience, because a lot of times when I have those conversations, we kind of look at them in two separate buckets. But that is a trend that I'm starting to realize, too, is those are coming closer and closer together, as they should be when we're focused on the people at the center of the transformation. One thing that you and I talked about while we were getting ready for this conversation is that you're seeing a lot more about data and how that is starting to influence the landscape a little bit more. So my last question for you is just to share some thoughts on how you see data coming into the conversation and how that might be different than the last couple of years.
Yes. Earlier in the year, I feel like we had like this whole LinkedIn chain conversation around predictions for what 2021 will hold. And one of them that I made was that data will be king. I absolutely believe in this sentiment. It's only March. So it's only almost March. So it's not really that far along. But in that time, I've produced two more events for the Intelligent Automation Network. The first was an executives event, really looking at how innovation could take place. And the second one is this large digital Intelligent Automation Week event. And during this time, you know, the key area of interest has been process discovery and process intelligence and process mining, also looking at machine learning and how, you know, you can combine all these tools. But and I know I've said it sort of a couple of times now, but looking at how to make your automation more intelligent requires data to not just, you know, you're not just applying these tools to your data, you're also feeding these tools with your existing data. What that means is that if you want to apply something like process mining to your systems, you know, you really have to have your data in check, because otherwise it can be quite an expensive activity. Because if you don't have your data, you know, the tools that are used in order to conduct this activity can often be expensive, and especially if it's based per the amount of data that you're using. You know, that's important to keep in mind. I know that the phrase garbage in, garbage out is like particularly well loved in this industry, and I think that that is definitely the case here. You know, RPA was basically like in the earlier, when we were talking about RPA, it didn't really need data. It was a click, you know, it was monitoring clicks, and then it was repeating those clicks and keystrokes. But when we look at the more advanced tools, they really have to learn. And in order to do that, they need to be able to trust the data you're feeding them. So I think that that's really, I mean, I know I've just gotten on a soapbox and ranted about data for about 2 minutes, but I really, I feel so strongly about it because it seems to be one of the larger hurdles that people face in my conversations with them.
On because going back to what you said, as we start to look at the maturity of the industry, specifically looking at like things like process mining coming in to point us in the right direction of where automation needs to take place, data is going to be king because data is going to be what's driving a lot of those decisions in the background. So again, totally warranted soapbox to end our discussion today. But thank you so much for joining me, Jordan. Anybody that's interested in learning more about the events that she's producing and or the podcast, please follow over to her LinkedIn, and we'll also include a link to the podcast for you guys all to check that out and some of the really great conversations that she's having. But with that, thank you so much again, Jordan, and have a wonderful day.
Thanks for having me, Emma.
If you're looking for expert tips on how to get started with your transformation or looking to hone in on your approach, make sure that you subscribe to our channel to catch our weekly Digital Transformation Talk series, where we interview experts from around the world on how to make it happen.